What's the matter now?
Tonight, you will not know. There's a lot of places that you can park, but there's other places you can't.
That's right.
The green grass is green, I always pour the ditch, but you better not pour over, they're gonna get problems. Go on over there, you man. You go on over there, pour that fence over there. It's green, huh? You gonna get bogged down, it's gonna miss you. It's gonna skin you up. Amen. And sometimes we gotta understand with God that we gotta be content with what God gives us. Amen. That contentment is a blessing from the Lord. Don't let the devil trick you. I thank God for my wife. I don't think I'm thinking about somebody else. The devil is alive. The devil is alive. But I'm just trying to say, let me let y'all know something. You can get uncontent and mess yourself up. You can backslide by being uncontent. Literally backslide from God when you become uncontent. Let's go to Isaiah 26 and verse number 3. Isaiah 26 and verse 3 says, "Thou will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusted in thee." Amen? Thou will keep him in perfect peace. How many somebody said perfect peace? Got perfect peace with Jesus. Amen? When you put your mind on Jesus. But when you begin to look over there on the other side, you're going to mess up. It's hard to backslide from God to contend with God. It's hard to leave somebody that you love. But when you stop falling, when you stop loving them, it's easy to cheat on somebody that you don't love.
That's right.
Amen. And that's as in the natural, that's in the spiritual. Amen. The reason why some men cheat on their wife because they really don't love their wife. They really don't love. And I've heard men talk about, "I love her, but this is a different thing." Baby, no, it ain't. Jesus said, "If you love me, you're going to keep my commandments. If you love me, you're going to be faithful to me. If you love me, you're going to be there through thick and thin, water, all this kind of stuff that come up. High water, flood, all that kind of stuff. Snow, stones, all of that. You're going to be with them, amen? Because you love them, amen?" See, sometimes it's a love thing. See, when you fall out of love with Jesus, you become uncontent. Has anybody seen the young people? I got to say it. I got to say, "Oh, Jesus, help me here." The young people get tired of looking prim and proper. So they look out to the world, and they see the world dressed in a certain way, and the world got a certain swag. So what they do, they adopt the mannerism of the world because they're not content with God. They're not content with God. The reason why they go out there and they fornicate is because they are not content with living holy. Baby, even though the Bible tells us that we live right, walk right, God will bless us. And you just want to try one time. And one time with the wrong person can mess you up. One time. Let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18. Dealing with God and his contentment. Let's deal with our finances real quick. Being content with your finances, amen? What? Being content with your finances. I should be making more. Raise your hand if you think you should be making more. Is anybody out on the street, living on the street? I see look at the majority of the church say, "I should be making more." Praise the Lord. Hey, can I be real? But can I be real with y'all? How many of y'all living on Skid Row? How many of y'all gonna leave church tonight and go live up on the bridge? Don't all jump and raise your hands at once. So that's telling me that you got a house to live in, right? How many of y'all are discontent with your car you drive? Discontent. Hey, raise your hand, Shane and Del. Now, raise your hand, Shane and Del. Raise your hand, Shane and Del. How many of y'all walk in the church? Do you see what I'm saying? How many of us are walking? Ain't nobody walking in the church. Let me let y'all know something. When I was 14 years old, and really, I repented of my sin and got older, I walked to church every Sunday morning. About a mile, maybe a mile and a half to church, I walked. Nobody gave me a ride. And guess what? I would go through a cut-through because I got tired of seeing people walk past me, drive past me, and give me a ride. I walked through the woods. The kingdom would ride past me and wouldn't give me no ride. It was still a mile and a half to church. Even after cut through the woods, cut through the basketball court, it was still a mile and a half to get to church. And I walked. I walked in the 80 degrees. I walked in at 9 degrees. Praise, I walked to church. And I walked back home. Every now and then somebody will give me a ride. But see, you gotta learn how to be content, amen. Some of y'all not content with the living space that you're living in. Raise your hand, raise your hand. I want a bigger house, bigger house, bigger, 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 bigger. But let me let y'all know something. God has been content with the great game.
Amen.
Do you understand what I'm saying? Let's go to the Word of God right now. Let's go to, see, the Bible said, Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18 said, it is God that give you power to get wealth. Now, my question to you, when he give you that power to get wealth, what in the world are you going to do with it? What are you going to do with it when he bless you with it?
Amen.
When God give you the power to get wealth, what are you going to do with it? See, we're always praying for more money. What you going to do when you give more money, baby? What you going to, you ain't got no plan for it, right? You're going to go poor. It's the truth, you're going to go poor. If God bless some of us with $1 million, we'll go blow it, baby. We'll be balling, we'll be wilding and dining, we'll be riding, styling and profiling and out. And in a year, it'll be pretty much, maybe about 5 years, be gone. $1 million. What you going to do when God bless you with the power to get with? Are you making any plans for it? What are you going to do with it? Are you just asking for more? It's the truth. The Word of God says, Deuteronomy chapter number 8. Please read it, Minister Miles. Please read it.
But thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, for it is he that giveth thee power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant which he sware unto thy father, and it is this day.
So it's God to give you power to get wealth for a purpose. So God give you the power to get wealth for a purpose. Can I be real? I gotta say it, Mama.
Yeah.
I'm gonna say it. Why in the world do two people with a dog named Google need $1 million house?
Amen.
I don't care if you got 10 children. I don't care if you got 10 children. I'm talking about myself, I ain't talking about nobody. I don't care if we got 10 children. You don't need $1 million house.
Jesus.
Some things is wasted. See, we go to the point where God wants to supply our need, and now we want to supply our greed.
Yeah.
Jesus.
I ain't blessed with $1 million house. I ain't gonna turn it down now, but I ain't gonna go out. Do you understand me? Can I be real? Everything you got is temporary.
Yeah.
My Lord, can I be real? I never really had a chance to appreciate something because I wasn't content. Jesus. Can I be real? Something I couldn't appreciate because I wasn't content.
Yes.
I wasn't content with the car that I drove, so I want another car. So I wasn't content. Did you ever take the time to take your time and ride real slow in that car and cruise and lean to the side? In that car. Said, nah, Pastor, I done that. I still want another car. I want to get another car. I'll get you another car, baby. Go get you another car. I'm just saying, I always want another house. Thank God for the house we live in. Amen. Can you appreciate where you're at first?
Yes.
Can you appreciate where you're at right now?
Amen.
See, if we don't start giving God the thanks where we're at, it's going to be hard for him to bless you with more.
Yes.
Can I be real? Why should he bless you with more when you don't appreciate what you got? I heard it when I was growing up, I used to have a man sing the song, said, you'll be crying with a loaf of bread upon your arm. You'll be crying with a loaf of bread upon your arm. Well, Pastor John, it's just a loaf of bread. God could have gave you some peanut butter, jelly. God could have gave you some bologna. But you got a loaf of bread upon your arm. See, there's people in Ethiopia. Somebody say, I get tired of talking about eating in Ethiopia. Let me tell y'all something. There's people in this country that's starving every day. Rat in this country. They don't get no food stamps. Ain't nobody gonna give them nothing. They starve.
Yeah.
They begging. They going in trash cans every single day. Right here in this country.
Yeah.
But you complaining. Yeah. I feel that there's a spirit of complaining coming.
Jesus.
And God wants you to continue. You tired of your marriage? You want another marriage? So you won't want the buster that beat you breakfast and lunch. You want the one that beat you breakfast, lunch, and dinner. So you get preach you for breakfast and lunch, and you want to go and get one to preach your breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and brunch. Y'all laughing. There's some single women who can't wait to get married, baby. Let me tell you something. to wait on the Lord. You're going to marry that monster from Hades. And that's amazing, and I can't wait to get married. I can't wait to get my own wife. But let me let you know something about a wife. You got to take care of a wife. You got to work for a wife. You got to provide for a wife. You got to do all that for a wife. Because guess what? If the woman freely decided any time, I ain't working no more. Oh, she going to work in my house. She's still in the book. You're the one to provide for her. Not she for you. Lord, please don't let my wife come. Yeah, amen. I'll be praying with you too. I mean, we can do it the way the world do it. Do it the way God say do it. It's a blessing to have a wife that's working. But baby, don't take it for granted.
Amen. Come on,
baby. Mama made a sign one day, I'm going to stay home with these kids.
Yeah.
And you got to go get a daddy. What you going to do? You going to divorce him? You going to get in trouble with God? And listen, ladies, it ain't time to tell y'all to quit y'all jobs. The devil is alive. If you're working and you're making money and your house is content, your husband content, I would not be the one to say it. Because Pastor Jones going back to 2596 out 4 weeks. And you going back to that house. And what worked over 2556 out Gordon Street may not work at your house. Amen. So we got to learn how to be content. We got to learn how to continue. Let's go to 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 1 and 12. Pastor John told me to quit my job. I ain't told you nothing. And I'm like, Les, I'm out of that mess. That's between you and your husband. Amen. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 1 through 12. Please read, Mr. Clark. Please read from me. First Timothy chapter 6, 1 through 12.
There as many servants as are under the yoke of their own master, worthy of all honor, that the name of God and his doctrine be not blasphemed.
Let's stop right there. See, there are people that come against the word of God because the word, they said this is all antiquated Bible because they tell the slave folks how to act. We ain't got no slave time now. No, we don't. Not in the United States. But see, the example that he was setting, he was telling the ones that were servants to obey their masters. Okay, what if there's somebody that's saved on your job? Respect them.
That's right.
If they're in a position of authority over you, respect them and honor them. That makes them more beyond. But let me tell you the truth. These slaves, the reason why I had to say that because the slaves got a revelation. Once they come to Christ, they're kings and priests. I might have these chains on me, but I'm a king.
Amen.
So you can talk like that all you want to. I'm a king. And guess what? They knew that they were kings and priests under God. And they knew the one that was their masters that was supposed to be saved was either out of God's will or they were just as good as them. And they knew that. Because Christ made it equal. Amen. So Paul had to give them instruction on how to act with their master. Please read.
And they that have believing masters, let them not despise them because they are brothers, but rather do them service because they are faithful and beloved partakers of the benefit these things teach and exhort.
Keep reading, please.
If any man teach otherwise and consent not to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which is according to godliness, he is pride, knowing nothing, but doubting about portions and strife of words, whereof coming envy, strife, rebellious, evil services, perverse disputes of man of corrupt mind,
yes,
and destitute of the truth, supposing that gain is godliness.
Supposing that gain is godliness. How many people believe you're going to keep coming to Christ, you're going to make you a millionaire? That's one of the biggest lies I've ever heard. God ain't trying to make you no millionaire. He might bless you with a million, but he ain't trying to make you a millionaire. A millionaire stats have nothing to do with God. He might want to bless you with 10 of them. So he ain't stunting no million. He might want to bless you with 999,000. He ain't stunting no million. Let me get that. He ain't stunting no million. So no, don't think you're going to give me $1,000 or $150,000 or whatever and then
God, God bless you. Be a meaner. God, you give it to me, and I'm going to use it. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. But guess what? It don't mean God going to make you meaner. It don't mean God gonna make you mean it. And why when they ask for money, there's only gotta be $1,000. I believe somebody here got $1,000. Why it gotta be $1,000, baby? Why can't it be $90? That's all I wanna give tonight. Y'all have to, y'all pray for me, because I tell you, my big, I'm gonna tell the truth. I knew when I would go to church and the preacher started that stuff, I need my money to come. I need my checkbook at home. Man, I'm the devil. This is like, I ain't write no check for no $400, $500 just because you asked for it. And the God said, I perceive it's somebody in here that can give me $100. Now, if I had it in my pocket, I would give it. But see, I got wise to that. See, going into tax season, I believe there's somebody here that can give me $1,000. And guess what I say? It sure ain't me. Give me no $1,000. All right, leave that alone. You see, Pastor John, you're gonna stop your blessing. Amen. Just tell me what I've done. Amen. I'm just telling you what I've done. I ain't said I will never give $1,000. I will give whatever it takes. The Lord tell me to give, I'm giving. Right.
Amen.
I have more than that, more than you might give me. But I'm just saying, don't let nobody manipulate you. Don't let nobody control you. Don't. If you notice you got a begging preacher, I got to get it. If you know you got a begging preacher coming to preach, baby, it might be good to keep your checkbook at home. Now, if the Lord say, bring your checkbook, you better go get it. If you got it locked up in your car, tuck away in the key, go out there and get it under your key, under your glove compartment, go get the checkbook, go make it right there. Because the Lord said it. But if you got a begging preacher at home, come to church tonight. Oh, leave him alone. So supposing that godliness was that came to godliness from suffering God. If you around people that think that serving God is gonna make you rich, you gotta be careful.
Yeah.
And guess what? God can and will give you power to get wealth. Yeah. But it ain't about becoming rich. Read the last scripture, verse 6.
But godliness with contentment is great gain.
Oh, well, listen, I can't stop it. Please keep reading.
For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out.
And it is certain. And it's certain. Naked you came into this world, and you're going to go out and let somebody put some clothes. You're going out naked and let somebody put some clothes.
Amen.
You can't take nothing with you to the grave. You can't take nothing with you to the grave. So don't get so fixated on money.
That's right.
I believe God gonna bless. Some of y'all are gonna be very wealthy, some of y'all gonna be very prosperous. Guess what? You better keep God first.
Amen.
Because money will fly away on you, it's like wings. And the only thing you got left is Jesus. You better keep Jesus first.
Amen.
You better keep Jesus first. And you better learn how to be content with what God bless you with. Please. Please. Philippians chapter 4, verses 11 through 14. This ain't one of them shout messages, because sometimes.